Thank you. Actually, it's kind of cool being anonymous in a town that you grew up in and everybody kind of knows you in. So I like that. You don't have to know anything about me, but actually what I'm going to tell you today is you're going to learn a lot about me. And this little presentation was inspired actually in a FUZE planning meeting. I'm on the planning committee. And one day at a meeting, I was perusing some of the materials that Steve and Calliope were passing out. And in addition to the main theme, listen to your three sisters, I was looking at some of the materials and I kept seeing this phrase, sitting at the same table. And we haven't talked about that as much, even though we've all come together here at this table to share our experiences. But it really made me think about, what have I learned sitting at the same table with some of the most important people in my life? And because this is the way I think, and as a writer, I just decided to brainstorm a little bit about some of the most significant passages that have to do with sharing and communicating and eating that have happened when I sit down at the same table. So this is called Sitting at the Same Table, a Culinary Reminiscence. Sitting at the same table with those I love and have lost. I can see their faces through the foods they loved, hear their whenever I taste the lip-smacking sabores that filled their stomachs, fed their spirits. The same foods, same flavors that fed our conversations, fueled our celebrations, connected our lives. I can see myself as a young girl sitting at the same table with my grandfather, Don Manuel Luján. In those days, Sunday afternoon meant staying with Grandpa while Mom and her sisters went to FUZE cafeteria to smoke, sip coffee, eat millionaire pie. After reading the Sunday funnies, before settling in to watch Wild Kingdom and the Wide World of Disney, we sat down for lunch. For me, it was peanut butter and jelly or Campbell's chicken noodle soup. For Grandpa, it was something from a culinary rainbow. Red chili, chile verde, golden chicos, brown pintos, blue atole, and always, for dessert, a snow-white disc of queso de vaca with amber honey spread like sunshine over the top. Grandpa ate in living color, in the vivid, farm-fresh, richly simmered hues of his Hispano heritage and mine. I still had not grown into the flavors he savored. The chili was too hot, the chicos too chewy, the queso too full-bodied, the atole too weird. Yet these were the seeds that rooted me in the unique gastronomic history of my New Mexican home. I was also too young to know my grandpa, the educator, the politician, the chili farmer, very well. And he was a man of few words. But through our weekly feast, in the loving act of an old man sharing a meal with a young girl, I began to understand the preciousness of family and the relationship-building ritual of food. For the most part, our ritual was confined to Grandpa's house, for by then he rarely left home. When he did venture out, it was often for a trip to my house with one purpose in mind: to sit at the same table with my family and eat my father's famous pozole. My father's name was Reyes, which literally means kings. And indeed, he made pozole with a regal flourish, using a simple, straightforward recipe that surely reflects the peasant origins, and I mean this in the best sense, of many New Mexican mainstays. No canned hominy here. Only sun-dried pozole soaked overnight. No cilantro or oregano or delicately minced onions. Just a little salt, some garlic, and large rough-cut cebolla chunks. No veggie pozole in Dad's castle. Pozole packed with only the purest farm-raised pork. And not just pork meat, but cueritos, pork skin. Plus, the grand pork finale, pig's feet. Ooh, you say. You had to eat it to believe it. And who can forget that delicious denouement? Dried red chili pods tossed whole, skins, seeds, and all, into the soupy, juicy depths of Dad's New Mexican delicacy. For my father, pozole making was an art reserved for their most special occasions. New Year's Day, birthdays, snowy days, days when Grandpa came for dinner. He assembled his creation in a pot so big it barely fit on the stovetop. His solution? Cook it outside, on the grill. The same grill where every day he roasted bushels of green chili, patiently blistering each pepper one by one by one. Just as the smell of his annual chili roast wafted through the neighborhood on the autumn air, the scent of his grilled pozole permeated our backyard in all seasons like a magic potion. He was a pozole legend, and his family, his neighbors, and his friends prodded him for his cooking secrets. The secret, Dad swore, was in the juice, in the mysterious multicultural consommé where the generations-old tastes of our ancestors mingle, where whole red chili pods stew and soften into feathery strips of spice, where inch-thick tortillas, sunk in perfect unison with every spoonful, soak up the memory of our most meaningful family traditions. By the time Grandpa went home, there was hardly anything left, except perhaps for a few tortillas that his sister, my great aunt, Tia Clara, had made before she came to sit and share them at our table. Tia was tiny, scarcely over 4 feet tall, and the diameter of her tortillas was no bigger than the span of her small and aged hands. She never married, and she rarely ate at home, and as a result, she wasn't too keen on cooking. Still, she made fat flour tortillas, the puffy, chewy stuff that gluten dreams are made of. The fact that they were tiny, like Tia, only made them more special. They were the hot, hand-rolled gift of a grandmother I never had, but who Tia filled in for. Who needed bread when you had Tia's tortillas to spread the love? If Tia Clara nurtured my love of tortillas, my best friend Mary furthered it. I met Mary when I was 6, and from then until we went our separate ways for college, we spent countless hours sitting at the same table in her family's agua fria kitchen, doing homework, devising ways to meet boys, discussing every detail, every outfit, every upset that defined our bright, scary, beautiful young lives. Mary's mother kept a refrigerator stocked with her own homemade tortillas and a pantry full of fresh apricot preserves. Almost daily, we popped a stack of tortillas into the oven and when warm, wrapped them tightly in a towel. There they sat in a steamy heap throughout the course of Coca-Cola-fueled conversations. One after another, we plucked them from the pile, slathered them in butter and jam, savored their molten mysteries. Plump, pliable, a sweet and greasy mess, tortillas were the perfect metaphor for our angst-ridden adolescence. We couldn't wait for the taste of tomorrow. Mañana, tomorrow, he said, I'll meet you in the morning for blue corn piñon pancakes. He was Father Mike, a Franciscan priest who had grown up in my father's East Side neighborhood and who I had heard of all my life. Born and raised in Santa Fe, he had spent most of his years ministering in Latin America. Now he had returned home to attend to his own gente in the Franciscan cradle of St. Francis Cathedral. From the moment I met him at a welcome home gathering, I knew he was no ordinary Catholic cleric. He wore a leather jacket. He rode a Honda Goldwing. He had read all of the same books and writers as me. Out of courtesy and curiosity, I accepted his invitation to sit at the same table over breakfast to talk about writing, reading, and the beauty of words. It was the first of many breakfasts together, our blue corn piñon pancake years, for Father Mike couldn't get enough of the nutty blue stuff. I couldn't get enough of his intellectual brilliance and of his bold, progressive opinions on politics, religion, and the decline of the Catholic Church. With every syrup-soaked bite, I chewed over his valuable insights and advice on topics as diverse as faith, philosophy, illness, aging, forgiveness. He was no preacher. He was a true mentor and friend who guided me through some of the most challenging years of my life, giving me confidence in myself as a writer and as a woman, giving me permission to eat pancakes whenever I liked. Father Mike was not blood family, but he was a cherished part of my Santa Fe clan. My mother and father both came from large tribes with 8 siblings each, as well as extended families formed over many generations of life in Santa Fe. My Hispano family is huge. Beyond my own 5 siblings, I was raised with aunts and uncles and cousins galore. That's not counting the tías and tíos and primos who aren't really related, but who I call tía, tío, primo, just the same. Within this grand family spread were 3 tías: Tia Maria, Tia Paulina, Tia Candelaria, better known as Aunt Mary, Aunt Polly, Aunt Candy. These tías' personalities were played out in the kitchen, and each had a flair for food that elevated them to the holy tía trinity of favorite family cooks. To sit at their tables was an eating adventure. Some dishes undoubtedly and deliciously stand out. Aunt Mary's natillas were a natural wonder, a seemingly simple medley of eggs, sugar, and milk, simmered with her slow and steady stirring hand to a fragile thickness, then served warm with a cinnamon-sprinkled cloud of meringue floating on top. Aunt Polly played with the fire of some of the hottest green chili I've ever tasted, slow cooking it to perfection with potatoes and lamb. And Aunt Candy always seemed to appear at just the right moment with a pot of her good-for-whatever-ails-you albondigas, a ground beef and rice meatball soup that was truly transforming. Come Christmas, the tías turned it up a notch. Aunt Mary made sweet cow tongue, yes, cow tongue, and piñon empanaditas in a chewy sopapilla dough. Aunt Polly made tamales in miniature, perfectly beautiful handcrafted bundles of corn masa, red chili, and pork that packed a monumental punch. And in a decidedly non-New Mexican holiday twist, Aunt Candy proved her prowess with that all-American item, Jell-O, creating everyone's favorite Christmas dessert, besides, of course, her bizcochitos, blueberry pineapple cream cheese pecan delight. Sitting at these tables, eating these foods, I grew up believing that life was a blueberry green chili delight. And then, I was 10 when my grandpa Manuel died, 25 when my best friend Mary met a drunk driver head on, nearly 30 when Tia Clara, Aunt Mary, and Father Mike moved on. Aunt Polly died in 2011, and my father Reyes was lost to me in March. Aunt Candy slipped away early this summer. Considering all the meals prepared and shared in the collective cocina of our lives, it might appear I am left here sitting at the table alone. It's true, there is no comfort in their absence. Every meal without them holds the dull ache of an empty stomach. But if I sit back and take stock of the table and the sustenance they laid before me, if I consider the full belly of my full life, I realize that our culinary connection is richer, our spiritual connection stronger, because they are gone. I am sitting at the same table with those I love, and though I have lost them, they are still here. There is nothing but comfort in eating and cooking the foods they cherished, and I cling fiercely to the recipes they handed down. The flavors with which they raised me are the flavors I crave: chile, chicos, atole, queso, pozole, pintos, tamales, natillas, albóndigas, empanaditas, tortillas with butter and jam, blueberry delight. I can see their faces, hear their voices, feel their souls stir every time I stir a spoon or stick a fork into their favorite dish. I can taste the bold flavors of their being. Every bite is a memory that nourishes my life. Thank you.